Hi guys, I'm Paul Kinlan and I'm a developer advocate at Google. And today we're doing the GDL Presents, which is Google Developers Live Presents, about the Chrome Web Lab experiment. I think it's the first of our current set of Hangouts that we're going to run. And with me, I've got Roger and Matthias.
Yep, that's correct.
Brilliant. I got them with me and they worked on the project. So do you want to kind of give yourselves a little bit of an introduction? And
I'm Roger. I'm a creative technologist at BeReal, and I've been the technical lead of the project.
I'm Matthias, and I'm a creative technologist as well, also at BeReal, and I mainly focused on the orchestra in the web lab.
Oh, cool. So what's your day-to-day like at the moment, your kind of average day?
I was managing all the developers and doing some programming as well as setting a little bit like the rules in terms of programming.
The technical direction and everything.
Yeah, a little bit. And handling a lot the client request as well, making sure that you guys were happy with everything.
Sweet. I'm always happy, so
And that's it, actually.
Yeah. And I was more into the code, writing both the front end and the back end for the orchestra and interfacing with the instruments.
Sweet. So we'll just do a little bit of a brief introduction about WebLab itself. So WebLab is a series of 5 real-world Chrome experiments that live on the web and also in the British Science Museum. And I think I don't know how long it's been in development for quite a long time now, hasn't it? But essentially, you can go to the British Science Museum today and start experimenting with the experiments in the real world. And today, we're going to talk mainly about the virtual world, but the online web experience. So you could be, the way I always like to pitch this was, you could be actually in the museum interacting with the experiment through the browser right there, walk 10 feet away, still be interacting with it, walk into the next room and still interact with it in like kind of like the same way that you would if you were at the museum. And then you go all the way over to Google I/O last year and then you're 7,000 miles away in San Francisco and you're still interacting with the experiments in the same type of way. I think that's a fair assumption.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a fair summary. So we're going to go through the actual experiments today. We're going to go through one, which is called the Lab Tag Explorer. And the Lab Tag itself is it's like the core component of WebLab, isn't it, really? So do you want to give a little bit of a background on what kind of WebLab, or not WebLab, but the Lab Tag means to you?
Yeah, so in WebLab, we wanted to represent people, the people that is interacting with it at all time. And a lab tag is your identification in WebLab. So it's something where it's like kind of like an avatar where you can store all the content that you generate in WebLab.
Cool. And if we look at the screen right now, we have these two streams. Are these kind of real time streams or random or?
Yeah, they are generated by code, and it kind of represents, one stream represents the online people, and the other one, the people that is interacting in the museum.
Yeah, and these are all lab tags are kind of streaming across.
It's not real data in this screen.
Yeah,
once we go into the Lab Tag Explorer is where we get the real data.
Cool, should we have a quick look in? We'll zoom in. That's pretty nice. And how was that built? Is this WebGL?
Yeah, this is WebGL, using 3.js.
And this is my lab tag is getting built right now. Can you explain a little bit why, what these kind of three symbols mean?
So each of the lab tags is generated by one main shape and two other smaller shapes. Mm-hmm. And there's a variation on rotation between these shapes, color, and size.
Yep.
And with only these kind of variables, we can acquire millions of different combinations.
Millions? Yeah, so that's cool.
So each of the lab tags is unique for each user.
Yeah, and you also get the lab tag online, but you can get it in the real world as well.
Yeah, the similar thing in the museum is that you get like a badge, mm-hmm. which you have your lab tag print, and you can put it into each of the experiments and collect all your data.
Right.
And once you go back home, then you can use your webcam to scan this badge.
Sweet.
And receive all the content that you have generated.
And I just want to kind of cover how do you interact with the webcam? Is that Flash or is it Get User Media?
Yeah, that specific bit of code was Flash.
Was Flash? Yeah. Is it Flash still?
Or it was this one. Yeah.
Okay. Cool.
For other things in WebLab, we've been using WebRTC, but in this specific one?
Yeah, I think this has been a really interesting experiment, really, where we've been trying to push the boundaries of what's been possible inside the browser. And, you know, there are some limits that we come up to. And I think in the later Hangout that we're going to run, where we talk about the Sketchbot, we use Get User Media, I think, to actually take a picture of the person from the webcam using JavaScript. But in this case, we use Flash, right?
Yeah.
I think this is basically, there are some things right on the web that we can't just do purely natively inside the browser right now, and we have to kind of do fallback. But it's a relatively seamless experience, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So. Yeah. And as you mentioned before, it's been in production for a long time. So when we started with it, we couldn't get user media.
Yeah, so I actually remember talking to you guys and saying, you know, Get User Media is going to be in the browser in 2 months' time. And then in 2 months' time, I'll be, it's going to be in the browser again in 2 months' time. So the really cool thing, at least about Chrome, and I believe Firefox as well now, and Opera, we have Get User Media, which allows us to get the user media. That's really bad, isn't it? It's like, it allows you to basically get access to the webcam data just by JavaScript. We're not going to see that today. We're going to go straight into the Lab Tag Explorer. You know what? I actually really like this whole kind of front screen. It's beautiful. Sorry, I'm just going to go and complete off track. That's fine. Cool. So the Lab Tag Explorer. Let's jump into the Lab Tag Explorer. So we were saying before, oh, this is beautiful. Really nice loading screens. So what's happening in the background at the moment? Is this?
So this is just loading all the specific bits for this experiment for the Lab Tag Explorer.
So do you kind of cache anything locally in the user's machine?
No.
Or is it just basically saying, you know, we're loading everything, and when it's like on load or DOM content ready, essentially we kind of
start everything. Yeah,
that actually it looks really nice. You normally see a big white page, and then so that's kind of interesting. That's one of the things I've been trying to work with developers on, is, you know, provide these relatively seamless experiences. Don't let the user see that there's a load, like things are loading incrementally in the background. Mm-hmm. Sometimes for documents it's fine, but I think for applications and those types of experiences, it's pretty. It breaks away from it. So should we just describe what's happening on the screen right now?
Yeah, so this experiment, it's all about exploring the content that all the users have been using. So as I mentioned, each of these little things is a lab tag, which represents a user. Awesome. And in this view, we can see the people who's actually interacting with WebLab in this precise moment of time.
Yeah.
You can see that there's two streams, one for the museum people, and another one for the people who's interacting online.
Cool. So the really cool thing, and I'd encourage anyone who can get to the British Science Museum in London, is that when you go into the museum, you see these lab tags falling from this, like from the ceiling right down to the floor, don't you?
Yeah, it's so nice. You have kind of like the same experience that we've been seeing in the online, but there it's represented in a very big screen.
Yeah. So I saw some kind of lines come up before when I clicked on someone from the US. There you go.
This is showing some connections between them.
Nice.
So people that probably they are having lunch, or people who are interacting with orchestra, some different data visualization of the users.
That's really cool. And these are actually kind of like live users now who are going or recently interacting with the Sketchbot.
Yeah, exactly.
That's pretty cool, isn't it?
And also these items flying by, it's we choose half an hour ago, all that has interacted since that part.
Right.
So it's constantly updated, and you can sit for hours and just look what people are doing.
This is really cool, isn't it? Mm-hmm. So, I mean, just to kind of talk about some of the technology about this, this is based on the user's kind of rough location. Is this using App Engine's request notification, or the request's country location information, or is there some other type of...
No, well, Telar did this bit, our partners, but I think they finally used some kind of custom built system to get the location.
So it just basically finds the country and then kind of maps that on. That's pretty nice. So the kind of the client side technology in this is all WebGL as well.
This WebGL is using 3JS, the same, and we've been trying to, for the movement of them, for the animation, we've been using steering behaviors.
Okay.
As you can see, there's some behaviors for them to feel a little bit alive, but at the same time, they all follow this path.
I kind of like how they've just like kind of tried to root themselves around where my mouse was.
When you roll over one. So this is a nice, interesting bit, which in 3D, it's quite tricky to, well, tricky to go from the 2D world to the 3D world, for example, with the mouse is in the 2D world, and then it needs to interact with some objects that live in this 3D world. But 3JS makes it very, very easy to.
Okay. So what, I mean, is that one of the reasons why you chose 3JS in this project?
Yeah. Yeah. Basically, without 3JS and with the time that we had, it would have been impossible. So
does Mr. Doob know that
we've been talking.
Yeah, he's cool, isn't he? Right. That's cool. That's really interesting. So these are kind of like boids, essentially, or
They are each of them. It's like a void.
Cool. And did you notice any kind of like performance issues? I mean, we look to kind of be streaming quite a lot of data across the screen at the moment. Were there any performance issues when you were building this?
There was actually. So these are all sprites, each of the lab ducks.
Yeah.
But if you use like one texture, you see that there's like an animation.
Mm-hmm.
So how this animation is done is using a spreadsheet.
Yep.
And if we were using just one spreadsheet per each particle, it was impossible to create this with so many particles. So what we ended up using is like a system where we generate textures as big as they can, which I think it is in browsers, I think it's a canvas of 2048 pixels. And then we fit in as many lab tags as we can, as many lab tag sprites per each of the lab tags. And then we have some kind of easy system to, with some indexes to access them. So we're using one or two very big textures, and we use UV mapping and UV offset to access each of the lab tags.
That's pretty cool. So I've actually just clicked on one of the lab tags, and we've got this little screen up here, which is the lab report. Can you explain a little bit about the lab report? I think you might have done it at the start, but
yeah. So the lab report is what is like what records all your interactions. So you can find all your content that you've been generating in WebLab in the lab report.
That's pretty cool, isn't it?
And some things need video to render recordings from the museum. If you draw yourself in the sand with a sand robot or a sketchbot. And the orchestra records you and gives you back a video as well. So that they may take time to render. Kind of, so you will see a progress here and can come back at any point and view your recordings.
That's pretty cool, isn't it? That's really nice. That's one of the things I really liked about the whole of the WebLab experience. I took my kids there, and well, one's only two, and he couldn't do anything. but Jack is like 6, going on 7 now, and he absolutely loved the place. He had his little lab tag. He checked into every single thing. We got back home, put the lab tag in front of the screen, and we could show that today, but I haven't got a lab tag from my kind of experience when I was at the museum itself. But yeah, we got it all back up on the screen pretty much straight away. It was a beautiful experience, really. It's pretty cool. So we have this other section. Sorry, I just wanted to jump in the location. Here we go. That's beautiful. That.
And here we're loading a lot of data.
Yeah.
For many days back in time.
And right. Okay.
And generating spreadsheets for this as well.
Yeah.
So this is probably a silly question. How's the data stored on the back end? Is it all in App Engine, or is it like in MySQL databases?
It's in App Engine.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Cool. So you kind of record everything that happens into App Engine and then kind of pull it back. When you bring it back, is it JSON?
Yeah. I mean, we're using JSON.
Yeah.
And it's amazing how the V8 JavaScript engine is working, and it is so fast.
Yeah.
So fast.
So how many kind of data points would you normally bring back, do you think, in that kind of? Because it took about 5 seconds to bring everything back, is it?
Yeah, it depends, obviously, in the traffic and everything. But I don't have any numbers, but it's thousands of them. Yeah. So and in each of them, there's lots of information. So
yeah. So it goes. You said it goes back over a couple of days, so we can, in theory,
jump
back over time.
Yeah.
So can you explain a little bit how you actually built this little time sequence thing? Is it just serious like a series of planes that you put into 3D space, or is it?
Yeah, it's basically. Everything is contained in a 3D container.
Yep.
And then we don't move the camera, we just move this container up and down, and it creates this effect of going back in time, some kind of like.
Oh, so you just move the camera?
No, so the camera, it's not moving, and then we have a 3D container that just move
up. I got you. That's pretty cool. So in theory, so if I look at it in this projection, is it everything after, like prior to this time, or is it just kind of at this point in time?
So this is at this point of time, and then if you scroll to the left, it goes back in time. You can see that it goes.
And this is all data that we've pulled, like that's been pulled back.
Yeah. And when you're scrolling, we're actually simplifying it a little bit because there were too many points.
Yeah.
And it was
like
scrolling
so
wasn't
like coalescing nice. Points and everything.
Yeah. So there's less points when you scroll and then when you release.
Iceland.
All of them up here.
United Kingdom. That's so cool. Wow, my little guy's moved up. Hey, cool.
It's quite interesting to see the different flows.
This is, yeah.
Days and locations.
Sorry, I'm just going to play with this for a little bit longer. No, that's insane. That's a lot of interaction, isn't it?
Yeah.
Cool. So I think we're close to the end. I mean, is there anything else you want to say about this experiment or kind of like technical challenges that you might have faced?
It's the performance. We tried to run the location view and had debug data from the start, and it was a set number of points, and it went fine all the time. And then we started trying it, and it crashed directly because we were filling it up too fast with points. But yeah, smart solutions and limiting the data.
Yeah, so like all the coalescing and everything, which it's pretty cool. Oh, that's beautiful, guys. Congratulations.